As I told you earlier, that we will derive the Schrodinger wave equations from the very basic equation. And that basic equation was, in our very first lecture, we did this thing, that there is the law of conservation of energy. Law of conservation of energy. And law of conservation of energy, I can write that the total energy is equal to the kinetic energy plus potential energy. I can write this as T plus V. And I can write that the change in this energy with time will be equal to zero. This is also law of conservation of energy, but different representation. And I have proved you this thing, that this d over dt will always come out to be zero as long as the energy will remain conserved. So I can write this thing as, let me write this one, E is equal, the kinetic energy is equal to half mv square plus the potential energy I write as V. This V is potential, this V I write a little bit tilted italic so that to differentiate this is velocity and this is potential energy. Now I can write this E is half M. If I multiply with M and divide with M, then this will become M square V square plus V. And I can write that this is P square, P being the momentum, over 2m and plus v. Clear? Now, if I, this is my equation, which I call my equation 1. And now I take back my psi. Psi is equal, means it is understood it's a function of x and t. So I will just write psi equal ei and kx minus omega t. If I differentiate this wave function with respect to x, d psi by dx, then I can write, okay, consider the things only in one dimension. When you consider the things only in one dimension, then you can write d by dx. If you want to consider the things in three dimension, here you will write kr. Then here you will write curly psi by curly x, means the partial differential equation you will utilize. So that difference should be in your mind. If I differentiate this with respect to x, then I will get what? It will be ik and e to the power ikx minus omega t. So I can write this thing as this is equal to I, k and psi again. If I double differentiate this thing, d square psi over dx square, then it will be again, means I, k will come and psi will come. So this is I, k squared and psi. And you know that I square is equal to minus 1. So this is minus k square psi. Right? Minus k square psi. Now for k, you know that what is it? You remember from the previous calculation that p is equal h bar over k. Okay? This is P equals H bar into K. So here I can write that minus, and for K I can write that this is P over H bar, and this is psi, and this is square. Clear? So I wrote this K P over H bar, and now I can write this thing, that d square psi over dx square is equal to minus p square over h bar square and sine. And if you allow me, then I will go back to my equation, and here from this one I can write that minus h bar square d square sine over dx square is equal to p square sine, right? And let's say this is my equation 2. Now I write my equation 1. Equation 1 is this one, e and p square by 2m plus v. If I multiply equation 1 with psi, okay, if I multiply equation 1 with psi, then I can write that 1 over 2m p square psi plus v psi is equal to e psi. Means just multiply psi on both sides. So e psi is equal to p square psi by 2m v psi. And now I know this value from equation 2. Equation 2, p square psi is equal to this thing. So I can write that minus h bar square in 2m this one, 2m d square psi over dx square plus v psi is equal to e psi. What this equation is? This is Schrodinger wave equation, which is time independent. Because we have not taken the time dependence yet. Time independent. This is time independent Schrodinger wave equation, and we got one thing from here we got that p square sine is equal minus h bar square over 2m and d square sine over dx square. I can write this that p whole square sine is equal to, if I write this one is p square sine, from here p square sine is equal to minus h bar square, there is no 2m, minus h bar d square psi by this. If I write this p whole square sine, and this one I write that this is h bar over I, and d over dx whole square and sine. Can I write like this? Because I square will give minus. Then from here, this is very clear that this p is equal to h bar over I d over dx. Now here, momentum already was something else, and now it has changed to a differential operator. Because derivative, this is a differential operator, it will act on something and it will change it. Like if this will be hyperbola or parabola, then when this operator will act on it, it will make it a straight line, because x square derivation will be 2x, it will be a straight line. So it is changing the thing, it's a differential operator. So we write that this is now the momentum, which was a physical quantity in classical mechanics, has become an operator in quantum mechanics. So here the physical property or the physical quantity, let me write not property but quantity, the physical quantity, when it comes into quantum mechanics, it becomes observable. And that observable then become an operator. Because it changes the state of the system. When in quantum mechanics you do measurement on a system, then you take many samples of equivalent systems, you operate one, then on the second, if the operator is different, you operate it on a new sample, not on the old one, because the old one has changed now. In classical mechanics, it is not that situation. Okay? Quantum mechanical samples are one measurement samples only. They are not repeated measurements, because every measurement changes the system. We will discuss this thing, that there are some operators which are not changing the system for each other, but some operators do change it for the other. They are called the commuting and the non-commuting operators. Commuting operators, they will not change the system for each other. Non-commuting operator will change the system. X and P are actually the non-commuting operators. They change the system for each other. So this we call the momentum operator. So in a very simple thing, we got the Schrodinger wave equation and we also got the momentum operator. Clear? Now again, let's say we differentiate our wave function with respect to t, then what we will get? Differentiate your wave function with respect to t, d psi by dt will be equal to all this and then the derivative of this minus I omega will come in. Minus I omega and e to the power I k x minus omega t. So this is minus I omega psi. And if I double differentiate this one, okay, no need to double differentiate, but this one is sufficient, that d psi over dt is equal minus I omega psi. And now you know about this omega. This omega from the previous. What we wrote, this omega, it was v equal to omega over k. But I can take a very simple equation, which is e equals h nu. Here nu is the frequency. I can write this thing as h bar omega. Because if I multiply this by 2 pi and divide by 2 pi, then h by 2 pi will make h bar, and 2 pi times nu will make omega, angular frequency. So from here I can write that omega is e over h bar. So I just write here that d psi over dt is equal minus I and E over H bar sine. Okay? Then I can write this one is H bar D sine over DT is equal minus I E sine. If I multiply both sides on I, like I multiply this on I and I multiply this on I, it will become I square, and I square is equal to minus 1, so minus minus will become plus, so this is E sine.
Clear?
I h bar d psi by dt is equal to e psi. Now come back to this equation,
which was time independent,
and put for e psi this value. So I can write h minus h bar square. From here, this equation implies that minus h bar square over 2m d square psi over dx square plus v psi, and for e psi we write our this thing, which is I h bar and d psi over dt. And this is the Schrodinger wave equation, but this one is the time dependent for our wave function. When our wave function will be time dependent, then we will have the equation like this. Okay, thank you.